we'll get started before anything else. So welcome back everybody to the weekly webinars. And tonight it's our arthritis month. We're going through everything related to preventing and treating joint problems. And tonight we're very, very privileged to have the wonderful Dr. Deb Torraca, who's a physical therapist for animals. It's been working with dogs and cats for 20 years. That actually is one of the founding members of one of the first physical therapy programs in a vet school in Tennessee. When was that, Deb?
Oh gosh. So I started that before my daughter was born. So probably in 1998.
So wow.
Yeah. So pretty good.
So without further ado, Dr. Deb.
Thank you so much. And I'm so glad to be back here. And it's Dr. Jeff and I definitely share like-minded approaches. And while I was having my panic attack of trying to get the PowerPoint up, I was listening to a lot of people talk about the weather and all of that. And certainly one of the things that I keep telling all my clients is, you know, the cold weather. I know I'm a little bit more achy in the morning and just throughout the day, but you know, the snow, and everyone thinks, oh, playing in the snow is so great for the dogs. And it's actually not so great. We're seeing more and more issues with all the snow. And this kind of ties into what we're talking about tonight with healthy joints and looking at, you know, trying to preserve the body as long as possible. I think Dr. Jeff knows this, but back in June, I had a total knee replacement, which I regret every day I get up. You know, I'm thinking, why didn't I just do what I tell my clients to do with their animals? And, you know, there's so many things that we could do to keep the body healthy, no matter if it's dog, cat. You'll see some pictures of some other animals that I work with. You know, the same principles apply. My older daughter is an avid equestrian, so I'm constantly looking at horses and thinking about that with everything. So when we look at, this is one of my clients, Meatball, and most dogs and cats, and as I said, let's face it, we're, you know, we have probably all experienced sore and tired joints at some point. If you're out there shoveling, if you're moving ice right now, when you come inside, you're most likely, you know, you're definitely feeling a little bit sore. You know, the slow movement in the morning. I have three dogs that I share my home with, and two are seniors. One is a 10 and a half Clumber Spaniel. And I definitely notice his stiffness with getting up in the morning, moving a little bit slow, coming down the stairs, and the same thing going up at night. I'm always glad when he follows me back and forth. And my dog training friends think I'm awful, but I think it's such a good sign when he jumps on the counter to steal something, because that's telling me his back and his hips are feeling pretty good. So I look at these functional things that go on. We know from research that most dogs after the age of 7 have osteoarthritis. In cats, it's a little bit later. I've been working with a lot of ducks and turkeys, and it's very interesting. They all of the ones that come into my office have arthritis. And definitely when looking at their, you know, just how they're brought up, and we'll see some pictures of some turkeys that I work with, but also in the aquarium, all of the penguins, because they're on different surfaces, have arthritis in their feet and also their lower thoracic region, which is, you know, pretty interesting. So I'm working with them, trying to figure out if we could reduce that soreness a little bit. And then can we prevent the ramifications of sore joints? So certainly, as I said, if you're feeling, you know, you're sore, I know I get grumpy when I'm in pain. And also whenever there's pain or inflammation, the muscles are going to shut off and not work as much. So we're going to get weakness going on. So it becomes this huge circle of pain and inflammation, reduction in strength, and that's going to make the joints more painful, more sore, and then it just keeps going and going and going. So we look at all of this, and you know, definitely sore joints are a way of life, but what can we do to prevent, you know, the issues from continuing? And, you know, certainly one of the things I always say, the first step to healthy joints is recognizing if there's a healthy joint or a sore joint. So as owners, I tell everyone this all the time, you know your animals better than anyone else. If you think something is going on, then there probably is. And when we compare, certainly humans, we know if we're off. I know when I get up and I'm stiff for probably the first minute of walking with my new knee. Dogs too will see that. It's a little bit tougher sometimes to see on dogs because of the four legs. Dogs tend to put 60 to 70% of their body weight on their front legs and 30 to 40 on their back. So they may transfer some more weight onto the front legs. And we'll get into some of the steps that I ask owners to take, but one of them is keeping a log, a monthly log of what your dog is doing or your cat is doing, what they're active in. And if you're good with it, if you're good with technology, take pictures and kind of keep track of that. So we're able to tell, you know, everything that's going on and all of that sort of stuff. And here are two, the boxer that's up on the table is standing a little bit under. And then the dog with their forelimbs up on the disc or their front legs up on the disc, we can see that the dog is tucking its back right leg in pretty tight and protecting that leg and just, you know, kind of keeping it tucked in and protected there. My dogs are coming in to see what I'm talking about. And, you know, again, here's just some more photos of recognizing lameness. The Cocker Spaniel, the blonde Cocker Spaniel here, one, we know that she is a little bit hefty. So there's a little bit more fluff on her than we would like, or a nice way of saying that she's overweight. But if we look, she's really got that left leg stuck out and that right leg underneath her. She actually had a hip surgery on the left, but she tore her cruciate ligament on the right. And we couldn't really do anything about the hip surgery. The owners didn't want to have surgery on the right leg, but her back was her source of pain. This was giving her a lot of discomfort. And she wound up just doing great by treating the pain and inflammation in her back and working on strengthening. And then the Newfoundland up here actually had some issues with both of his shoulders. And these guys are big. And his owner recognized right away that the dog started to have some issues coming down the stairs, was a little bit hesitant. So of course, dogs are not going to say, hey, I don't want to go upstairs with you. They may be just a little bit more reluctant to do things. And it's up to us to kind of determine, hey, is something off? And as we talk more about keeping those logs, this will make a little bit more sense. And then cats. So this was one of the kittens that we work with. And cats always say tend to be more of the silent sufferers, that should say. They'll be more quiet and not as engaged. So, you know, very often owners will say, yeah, you know, the cat's just spending more time upstairs, not coming downstairs and not spending time with me. They tend to sleep a lot. They may lose weight or gain weight, just depending. They may not jump on things. They may not want to play. They just kind of, you know, I always get concerned when someone says, yeah, I have a cat, and they only show up at mealtime, you know, maybe a little bit, a couple times a day. So, you know, what's going on with the cat? And, you know, certainly our feline friends suffer from osteoarthritis. They have cruciate tears, just like dogs do, spinal disease, trauma. You know, I watch what cats do, whether they're, you know, jumping off of these high bookshelves or anything like that. And I worry about the trauma that they could have inflicted upon them. So our proactive steps that we want to take, and I'll go through these one by one, certainly weight. And as we're in the middle of this pandemic and, you know, probably all of us, including our animals, have started to put on more weight. You know, we're just a little bit less active. Throw in the ice vortex that's moving across the US and North America. And that definitely has an impact on us. Healthy food. Oh, so we'll talk about this, and it's always something that I address. And, you know, we can't make changes with ourselves unless we're eating right. So we could do all the exercise that we want, but if we're not making a change with our diet, we're not going to have the results that we need. The same thing with our animals. Regular exercise is such a must. And simple things. It doesn't have to be, if it's 0 degrees out, you don't have to go out and walk your dog. There's plenty of things that we can do inside, you know, just to help mentally and physically. Supplements as needed. There's definitely things, our joints, the animals' joints could use some benefit. My third dog in my house is a clumber puppy. He's a little over a year, and I watch him do these crazy things with his body, and I'm already thinking, okay, what could I do here to keep him safe? You know, certainly keeping him lean, making sure he's getting the exercise he needs, but not overdoing it. Paying attention to changes. So very minor changes could be the first hint of something. You know, examples are the older dog that doesn't want to walk across a slippery floor. And they may be afraid because they fell at some point. They may be having some problems with their hips or their knees. So their balance is a little bit off. It could be their vision is off. They could be starting to having trouble and weakness more in the evening when they're more fatigued. So little things, you know, maybe the dog doesn't want to jump in the back of your SUV. You know, they only want to go into dad's car that happens to be a lower car. And I always say animals are very smart. You know, it's usually us that are not the smart ones. We'll get up and go to work. If we're sick, we won't rest. Dogs spend, you know, if they don't feel great, they'll spend some time resting. Quality of life issues. So, you know, looking, is your dog enjoying your life, their life, the same with their cat? Are they happy? And do they have full enrichment? You know, are they doing things that they actually enjoy? And most of the time, animals want to spend time with you, you know, whatever it is that you do together, whether you walk, whether you snuggle on the couch after your walk, do things like that. And then, of course, we look at a healthy environment. I always like to make sure our animals are in an environment that's healthy for everyone. You know, part of what I do with rehab is definitely considering the quality of life for the animals, but as well as the owners. So making sure the owners are taking care of themselves as well is so important. So we look at, you know, weight. So obviously this golden retriever, very funny story, kind of. It had a good ending. He lived in New York City in a high rise on Central Park, and his owner would walk him twice a day, and he would go to the food carts and get whatever he wanted. So the dog never had a regimented diet. It was just either hot dogs and pretzels and whatever. So two walks a day to the food carts. The dog had issues with both of his knees, needed surgery, but no surgeon would operate on him because he was so large. When he came into my office, he was 185 pounds. So a pretty big golden retriever there, and very food aggressive, and, you know, just wasn't sure how this was going to turn out. And he wound up moving in with a new family. And he wound up losing 65 pounds over the course of 4 months with a good diet, with just gentle exercise. And so it was quite nice. And then you see this turkey here. So she is one of my animals I work with. And she was actually bred as a meat turkey. And her weight was way too much for her legs. And the owners had noticed that she just, you know, was having trouble walking. She was limping. Her name is Bonnie, and she lived with Clyde. And was definitely overweight, but how do you exercise an overweight turkey that's hurting? So it was this, you know, huge thing. And thankfully, she is a very nice turkey. I was so excited the day that she was coming in, and my husband said, you know, a turkey can probably poke your eyes out. And as I was sitting down on the floor, getting, you know, up close and personal with her, that kind of went through my mind. But she is a very, very sweet turkey and is doing much better. And just employing this whole multimodal approach. So trying to decrease that pain and inflammation, and using an Assisi loop on her to reduce that pain and inflammation, and starting with exercise. Her owners actually put in a sand pit so she could walk in the sand pit and start to lose some weight. So no matter what, you know, the animals that we're looking at, we want to follow this multimodal approach. Make sure we're getting rid of that pain and inflammation so we can build up strength. And animals that are overweight, no matter what they are, have a reduction in lifespan. That's, you know, plain and simple. It's, you know, I'm pretty frank with owners when talking about it. And sometimes it's hard to see. I know I mentioned my two seniors, they definitely could lose a little bit of weight, and I know it, and it's a struggle. And I live with a, you know, my husband loves to feed everyone, including the dogs. So it's this constant, you know, battle. And sometimes it is hard to hear, and I don't always want to hear it, but I know what the ramifications are. And any animal that's overweight, we know that there's a higher incidence of joint disease, which we're trying to avoid, metabolic disease, cardiac and respiratory disease, and of course, depression. You know, look at this turkey, Bonnie, she wasn't able to move around a lot. So she was definitely suffering from depression. But we also had to think about the other turkeys in her little area, and she started to become attacked because she wasn't moving as much. So we were also dealing with, we had to save this turkey, and she's still doing great and doing wonderful. So a healthy diet. And this is, you know, something that I always mention, and I have two teenage daughters. So I'm constantly saying, if it doesn't exist in nature, why are you eating it? Why would we feed it to our animals? So I always ask owners to take a look at, you know, what they're feeding their animals. Coming out of a can and looking like a color that, you know, is just gross and horrible is not going to be the healthiest option. Some people are able to do much better with their animal's diet than others, but anything that you can do is going to help them. Again, like if we eat healthy, it's just going to provide so much for us and so much, you know, just many more benefits. Here is my Columba puppy here on one of our walks. I live in downtown Mystic, and I'm fortunate enough, the Mystic Seaport is on our walk, and they have parts of old ships and stuff in the parking lot. So we go and explore, and I kind of use them as, you know, just like little obstacle courses for him to get used to hind end awareness and that sort of stuff. But regular exercise is so important. And when we're not in a polar vortex, not freezing outside, I think going outside and walking is one of the best exercises that you can do with your dog. A little bit tougher with cats, but there are other things that we can do with them. But getting out there and just exploring. And I know I look forward to my daily walk, and it's one of the promises I made to myself to improve my life is getting out every day and walking. And whether it's raining, or I will say that the cold days, I've been bundled up and our walks have been a little bit shorter, but it provides so much physical and mindful enrichment, you know, just taking things in and everybody exploring everything that's going on. It's always the number one thing I mention to owners is get out and walk your dog. And it does wonders for both ends of the leash. Balance activities. So this is something that can be done inside, doesn't matter the temperature. And these are two young pups. The black pup, the Newfoundland on the side, we're working on a little bit of hind end awareness. And working on simple balance activities is imperative from when a puppy is just a few weeks old, when they can start to work on their balance, up to senior dogs. So this is going to be advantageous to help work on the dog's balance. We think about our older dogs that start to lose their balance. We know by working on the ligaments, the components of the ligaments, the Golgi tendon organs, the proprioceptors, that we're able to strengthen the area, also provide more feedback. There have been numerous studies done on people in nursing homes and working on balance activities as a fall prevention tool. So look at this with our senior dogs. Then our puppies that are learning a lot of body awareness, trying to figure out where they are with everything. The puppy in the coat was came from a rescue situation. They're trying to put weight on her. She had pan osteitis and inflammation of the long bones of the joints, fully recovered at this point, but we're trying to get some weight bearing, give her some body awareness, also help strengthen those bones and joints. And as simple as this looks, dogs fatigue pretty quickly. So it's something that we'll just work on little bits. This is one of the exercises I love to do, a simple pause up. Increases the weight on the hind limbs. So if you have a dog with hip disease or stifle or knee disease or just weakness in their rear, maybe from age, this is something that is a simple exercise to do. So front feet up, you can put it up on a step, on something unstable, transfers weight onto those back legs. Adding a head lift up will further transfer more weight onto that rear. So it's such a nice exercise to do with so many dogs. And this is something that you could do right before you feed the dog or right before you go outside. I do it with my senior dogs before they get their breakfast and dinner. They have to stand on one of these discs. So they stand and then they look up five times and then they get their dinner. Same thing before we go upstairs at night. They pause up there, they get their night-night cookies, I call them. And so we sneak it in. So it's always nice to, you know, try to get things in. I completely understand that life is crazy sometimes and trying to figure out how can I add more exercise in for my dogs is a tough one. So, you know, something very simple. This little dog is just so sweet. She is only a year and a half old. And she is a cross between a Labrador and a Lhasa Apso. And she has, as I say, four flat tires. So if you look at her front legs, she has like the ballerina feet. And so she has issues going on with her elbows and her wrists. She also has hip dysplasia and knee issues, stifle issues. So we're really working on her entire body. And this is really setting down short-term and long-term goals, trying to figure out what we're going to do to make sure we keep her as comfortable as possible. Owners don't want to pursue surgery. And really, if they operate on one, she'd probably have to wind up getting many surgeries. And that's not what they want for her. So we're trying to work her core a little bit. Of course, she's got that super long back. So having that long back makes the dogs a little bit prone to intervertebral disc disease, soft tissue problems such as iliopsoas issues, all of that sort of stuff. This is a dog that needs to keep the weight off because it would just stress her joints out way too much. She is very cute. So good core, we say, is good posture. And how many of you are listening to me and you're kind of slunking over? So you sit up straight, right? Like I remember my mom always saying, you know, stand up tall, get your back muscles to work. But certainly working on good core will help with good posture, which is going to alleviate stress on the joints. So something like standing on an unstable piece of equipment to dog beds, your bed, if you allow the dogs up on the bed, and just having them stand. And I always ask for dogs to, you know, look at their top line or the back. We want a nice flat top line. How long can they hold it for? The Irish Setter is, she's no longer with us, but she was the most famous Irish Setter bitch in history. And we had been through so much together with, she had hip issues. She had one litter of 15 puppies. And I was looking back on Facebook memories, and it was 10 years ago today that she made it to Best in Show at Westminster. And she wound up doing incredibly well up to the age of 13. So working on, even though she had hip issues, just working on her strength, making sure she stayed out of pain and she was in good shape. Here's some other just varying core exercises, getting a little bit more difficult, you know, standing on different surfaces, sitting. So sitting and just holding a tight sit. Again, as you're sitting there, look at your legs and what they're doing. And we could ask a dog to sit on an unstable surface like their dog bed and keep their hips in. This will help promote strong hips, strong knees, and a strong pelvic area. The little dog over the roller had back surgery, and we're working on just keeping some motion going there and some core strength with her. Simple weight shifting is something that we can always do and always laugh. The goal is not to push the dog over, but just shift the weight from side to side. And this is just a lovely exercise to do with dogs of all ages. It helps with body awareness. And the goal is to accept a little bit of weight on one side and then the other. And sometimes, you know, my older daughter makes fun of me when I'm standing in the grocery line or wherever, and I'll do a little weight shifting side to side, kind of like a check-in with the body. And this is nice to see if your dog is accepting all the weight on each leg, especially great for those seniors that need a little bit more weight on each side and you're trying to get them moving. We can work, again, just varying levels on an uneven surface. So four limbs up, we could get a little bit more weight onto the rear. When the back legs are up, we get a little bit more weight on the front. So for those dogs that have elbow issues or shoulder issues, elevating their back legs up just a little bit and having them look up and down will help strengthen up those shoulders and those elbows. So it's something, again, simple to do and you can incorporate in. And I always say you don't need a lot of fancy equipment. You can use dog beds. You can use folded up towels, anything like that. You know, certainly you could, you know, buy equipment, you know, for them as well. Sometimes that helps people keep a little bit more motivated. So here is a little bit more advanced, a little video of a dog doing just different obstacles here and stepping up and over. Not sure what that loud noise is there, but this is Gracie. She belongs to someone in my office, and we're just walking on, you know, unstable surfaces up and down. And this is a great enrichment tool. It also helps build up posture, build up confidence. And you could set this up in a lot of different ways in your home. You know, think about playgrounds, all that sort of stuff where you can sort of have a lot of fun with that. So something simple to do. Here, just another doing some.
So standing still is one of the most important exercises. What I would suggest is having the dog just start on land or a flat surface. You can definitely feed the dog. Any looking up encourages more weight bearing onto the hind end.
So simple there. Forgot my voice was there. So that's looking up. We'll just transfer some weight onto the back legs. And, you know, how often are our dogs looking at us? You know, if we ask them to look up without sitting, we can transfer weight onto the back. And again, this is great with dogs that have issues with their hind end. Most seniors are lacking some strength in the back, so we can get some weight onto there. And then, you know, certainly if you can't walk outside, land treadmills are always a good option for most dogs. I've seen some horrible things on YouTube and that sort of stuff. It's usually why I don't go surfing for different things, but you never want to leave your dog alone when they're on a land treadmill. You always want to supervise this. They should be supervised at all times, but this can be used as a strengthening tool, you know, certainly for endurance or working on range of motion. And we'll get always joke that if a dog walks 30 minutes outside, we only want to do about 10 minutes on a treadmill. And the reason being that they're not going to have the opportunity to stop and sniff. You know, they're going to be going pretty, you know, steadily. So they're not going to have that opportunity to take a break when they need to. And I always listen to their feet. So it's fairly normal, maybe once or twice for a dog to scrape their nails, but nothing more than that. If I hear them scrape their nails more than three times, they're getting tired. And there are dog treadmills out there. A big thing when we're looking at dog treadmills or human treadmills that dogs can use is looking at the length of the belt. So we want the length of the belt to be longer than the dog's stride length. So for example, I haven't found a treadmill yet that could accommodate an Irish Wolfhound or a Great Dane, just because their stride length is so long. If you have a Cocker Spaniel, if you have a Border Collie, you can most likely use a human treadmill. Again, we just want to make sure that the belt is long enough where we're not stifling their movement. So it gives us another opportunity to work with our dogs. Here's underwater treadmill. Oops, sorry there. And just for fun, here you can see some dogs working out. Got nothing in my brain. That's what people say. Mm-hmm. That's what people say. Mm-hmm. I go on. So we can see to Taylor Swift, the dogs have quite a lot of fun in the underwater treadmill. And with the underwater treadmill, there's a lot of properties of water that help in so many different ways. So we have the certainly the buoyancy, we have the cohesion, we have the turbulence that will help to strengthen, but it also reduces the stress on the joints. So just depending upon what's going on with the dog will dictate how high we want the water or how low. The higher up will reduce the body by anywhere from 70 to 80%. So we don't want it too high. We don't want them swimming. This is a weight-bearing exercise. And we can start to put on some nice muscle, as well as, not the dogs are not in pain. We're not going to push them to that point. It's also very beneficial to kick off some weight loss, depending upon how much work they do in there. Walking in water burns 3 times as many calories as walking on land. So it's always a nice little push to get them, starting to burn some more calories and starting to get moving. One of my clients who I just love so much, he was trying to get his dog ready for the Clumber Spaniel Nationals. And we're trying to get him in shape and lose weight. And I couldn't figure out after 6 weeks why the dog wasn't losing weight. And he said, "Oh, Debbie, after we leave here, I go and buy him some donuts because he's worked so much." I said, "Oh gosh, so you're like completely negating the effects of the underwater treadmill for the weight loss." So of course, underwater treadmills are not on every street corner, but making your own underwater treadmill. So when it's not freezing outside, using a water body such as a lake or the beach to walk in the water. One of the big differences between walking in the water and swimming is that walking is a weight-bearing exercise. We're getting the joint compression and distraction. So it's a little bit more functional. Swimming is still a great activity, but it's not the be-all and end-all. We have to make sure that the dogs can swim, that there's no stress being put on, especially the spine. And if there's soft tissue conditions, such as iliopsoas strain or bicipital tenosynovitis, we can actually aggravate that. So we want to be careful. So when we look at supplements, so there's a lot of different supplements out there. And I think it's very important to take a look at and work with your veterinarian to decide what is going to be best, for the, for you and your dog and what's going to work. Certainly looking at the variety of joint supplements that are going to help, omega-3s and our things like glucosamine and that sort of stuff. Always important to take a look at. And I had mentioned looking at keeping a daily or a monthly journal rather. And so we always want to determine if the dog is, if they're hurting or if things have changed or anything like that. So as I said, I recommend keeping this monthly journal. And maybe the beginning of every month or whatever works for you when you're paying bills or something that is going to cue you to work with your, to remember to do this. And in this monthly journal, which certainly many of us don't keep paper journals anymore, maybe keeping a file on your computer, looking at what the dog's activity level is or your cat's activity level or your duck or anything like that. So how active are they? Are you taking them for walks? Are they playing in the house? Is your cat coming downstairs and visiting? All of that sort of stuff. What is their food intake? And be honest. So Christmas time or the holidays, many animals get more food. So what's been going on? Did Aunt Thelma come to visit and is feeding the dog too much or anything like that? So taking a look at, what is their coat and skin like? Many times in the fall, when people turn their heat on, the coats tend to get drier depending upon the type of heat. But, do they need extra supplementation, especially of the omega-3s? What does their skin look like? I always pay attention to their paw pads. Is there dryness, anything else going on there? Exercise, what are you doing with the dog or the cat? So are you walking them? This will differ a little bit from the activity because, what are you purposely doing with them? What are their normal activities for that month? If you're involved in sports with your dog, are you competing in agility or maybe doing any scent work, anything like that? And then if you're able to take photos, and I always recommend taking photos from the front, the back and then each side and putting them into that file. Because then if something you're suspecting that something is going wrong, you can look back a couple months and say, oh, you know, Bogart was standing this way. Now he's not. You know, what's going on? Why is he demonstrating some weakness or anything like that? So always so important. And I encourage owners to start this from the moment they bring their dog home or their cat, whether it's a rescue, whether it's a puppy, anything like that, and establishing what their norm is. Nail care, always something that I go crazy about, is so crucial for healthy joints. And this was a dog that came in last week and could tell how bad his nails were. And the picture on the left is before we cut his nails. And then the picture on the right is after. And you could see the reduction in stress in his wrist or carpal area right away. And it's definitely, you know, something taking care, cooperative care of nails and things like that is tough, without a doubt, but so important for joint health. And I always teach owners about this. Puppies, you know, just get them used to trimming nails. Many times older animals are very painful when you go near their feet, and it could be from nails, it could be from the adaptations that the nails that the body has made due to the position of the nails. And as I had mentioned, most dogs older than 7 have osteoarthritis. Cats, just depending upon the size, usually after the age of 9. And this is going to definitely worsen with increased weight and that poor structure and posture. And there's so many different things out there to help treat. This is the meatball that we saw a picture of, and he's got elbow dysplasia at a young age. And we're using something called pulse shockwave therapy to help reduce some of the stiffness and the pain in his elbows and his shoulders. And this is a treatment that's very effective and helps significantly. And as I had mentioned with the multimodal approach, we're always going to look to reduce pain, reduce inflammation, and that in turn is going to help us improve strength and restore function. And this is always, I would call it like the magic little circle to have a healthy and happy dog and client. So reducing that pain and inflammation, and there's so many ways to do that, and then improve the strength and help with their function. So as I mentioned, osteoarthritis is so common, and there's so many ways that you could treat it. This Great Dane has very painful arthritic feet, and just causes him to walk very slowly, and really has just changed his entire life. And there's certainly so many approaches, you know, whether if you go from a standard pain management NSAIDs to nutraceuticals for osteoarthritis, acupuncture, chiropractic, physical therapy, there's so many modalities that can work to help treat the pain and the inflammation and the malfunction associated with osteoarthritis. We always want to understand what is going on. I always joke, talk with our patients, but pain management is key. And we use a lot of laser, a CC loop, and then looking again, going into that multimodal approach, looking at what exercise is appropriate. It is not appropriate to take a painful 11-year-old dog and have them run outside for exercise, although I see this quite a bit. So I mentioned the various treatments. Photobiomodulation or laser is very effective in reducing the pain and inflammation associated with sore joints, soft tissue injuries, osteoarthritis. Plain old ice that I learned after my knee surgery, ice became my best friend. So cryotherapy or ice, moist heat works wonderfully. Sometimes electrical stimulation like a TENS unit. The only drawback is you have to shave the area. The Assisi loop, which is pulse electromagnetic field therapy, And then there's other different types of PEMF. Some, the Magna Wave works great to reduce pain and inflammation. There's a lot of good things out there. And I mentioned the quality of life, and I thought this was a great quote. If you're stressed, your companion will be too. So remember to stay calm and positive. And I always say that with, you know, everything in life. You know, I have teenage daughters, so there's lots of episodes where I could stress out, and I always try to remain calm. But I think about that with my dog's lives and also all the animals that I work with, about everybody's quality of life matters. So trying to stay calm and keep it together. And enrichment activities. So probably in the past few years, snuffle mats have become such a popular item. And these are so great for so many reasons. I mean, definitely to keep a puppy occupied. But there was recently an article that snuffle mats for senior dogs and dogs that have neurological issues, such as degenerative myelopathy and similar issues, by working on snuffle mats, we're improving their respiratory muscles with their deep breathing as they're in there, they're standing, and you could put this on a varying level. If the dog can't go down all the way, you can elevate it on a book or a step stool or anything like that. These are great enrichment tools to get in there. And snuffle mats, they're all over the place right now. I'm a big advocate of shop small. So for those of you that are in Connecticut, North Point Pets is such a great spot. I'm sure there's local stores that have fantastic snuffle mats. You can make them also. And these mats, there's food in there. So you put food in there, put snacks in there. Of course, we always want to watch the weight. So if you're doing snuffle mats, you don't want to feed them as much. But this is fun. We do a lot of this in the clinic to keep dogs occupied. We can have different mats that phthalate free. We can put peanut butter in there or frozen yogurt, that sort of stuff to keep them busy is fantastic too. And I mentioned pain management, just some other pictures of the ice. Cervical ice packs for people are great for dogs. Same thing with hot packs. This gentleman in the hot tub bought a hot tub for his dog to allow his dog to feel better. I always thought that was great. And then electrical stim, that sort of stuff. Some other pictures there. Range of motion, if you feel comfortable with it, just doing gentle range of motion on your dog's joints. This helps keep them, definitely loose. That we have the neurological effects of mobilizing and range of motion and helping, but it also allows you to understand what normal is. So if you could bend their knees, their, move their hips, and maybe you feel a little bit of snap, crackle, pop, or again, what is normal? And this may be something you write in your journal.
With and Dr. Deb, as you're going through this, would you sort of keep mentioning cats? People are concerned that what you're talking about, Absolutely. They can't do with cats, and I think they can.
Yes. Thank you very much, Dr. Christina. So certainly you could do this with any animal and working with your cat. And I do highly recommend if you have a kitten, start doing this, the same with the nails, as soon as you can. So starting to work with them and find out what is normal. When you're moving their joints around, what do you feel? And does the dog get upset with you? And the cats may be a little bit more expressive and let you know. The dogs may give you licking their lips or giving you other signs and that sort of stuff. But again, understanding what is normal for your pet. So in summary, and again, of course, everything that we talked about can be applied to cats, maybe not swimming. Although we've had a few dogs a few cats in the underwater treadmill. I've had a few cats jump out, but they definitely do well with it. So we, you know, we want to look at whatever we can do to improve their quality of life. And as I mentioned, definitely looking at prevention and catching on sooner than later. So what is, you know, establishing what is normal and then moving on from there. And there's a wide range of methods to assist, you know, lots of things to do. And we look at the different modalities, you know, everything can be applied to just about every animal. You know, as you saw with the turkey, I see many ducks as well. I work with a duck sanctuary. So all of this can be applied. And, you know, I'd probably say that we see probably about 5% of cats in our facility. And it's all owners will always say, I never knew that they were hurting so much until they start to feel better. And then their cat starts to go crazy and is scratching on everything again and doing wonderfully. So that's always wonderful to, you know, to hear and to see as well. So it's always so good, you know, to do that. But thank you. And thank you for the technical issues there.
We have a few questions. We'll go a little bit later. Great talk. So Sharon said her cat spends about 5 minutes every time she gets in bed with her, massaging her front legs with her paw and her paws. And she's wondering what part of her is like, what's that helping with her?
So absolutely. So if you're, I mean, everybody loves a good massage, so you're definitely helping the cat's well-being. But if you're massaging the forelimbs and the neck area, you're definitely helping loosen up those front legs, which cats rely on so much for their jumping and for their landing. And if the cat is very active and does a lot of jumping down, I would definitely spend a little bit more time up on their neck area and massaging up there, because that would be great to work with. So, and just like, and I always let owners know, some animals absolutely hate to be touched and some love it. So I don't take offense if you try to massage your cat and they say, ooh, you know, I don't want to do that. So.
And another question was, with cats, are there specific exercise tools and toys that are available, and can they find those maybe on your website? Do you have an article about cats there?
Yes, so there is. If you can, I'm redoing the website. So if you cannot find it, just email me at deb@wizardofpaws.net. I do not recommend the laser pointers making your cat go crazy. I think that can cause too many other issues. I've seen aggression. I've seen, for lack of a better term, psychotic behavior come out from it. And, but using things like, you know, toy mice or little teaser pulls, and we want to keep them level. So just like we wouldn't ask a dog to jump up 8 times its body height, we don't want to do the same. We don't want to do the same with a cat. So we want to keep it level. And we think about a cat walking on a treadmill, probably not going to happen, but they can, you know, follow you up and down the stairs. And we can do a lot of repetitive exercises like that. The balance exercises that I showed, we can do that also with cats. They could be on an unstable surface, walking across the couch or anything like that. And I definitely recommend making them work for their dinner too. They're not immune to that. So absolutely.
And then Debbie asked, she has a dog with cerebellar hypoplasia. And I just suggested she really stay ahead of the ball by doing all of the exercises she can, as well as homeopathy, acupuncture, Chinese medicine, Tellington T-Touch, acupressure, massage, because when they got cerebellar hypoplasia, they're going to be off, right?
So actually, we've had quite a lot of success. And the first few that I treated, it started with, well, let's try this, and using photobiomodulation to the suboccipital area or right below the head to increase blood flow. And we've had really some great success with keeping we've had probably about 10 dogs and a couple cats. For some reason, I'm seeing a ton of sheep-a-doodles with this. And so keeping them moving and definitely, yeah, staying ahead of the game and looking at their movement and helping. It's a tough one to watch, but we had a Siberian Husky live to the age of 9 and great owners. And he came in for laser photobiomodulation once a week and did really well. So it was lovely to see.
And then finally, Donna said she had a dog with a plexus injury in the shoulder, and the vet would not refer them to UWTM because they said it would cause further harm.
No.
And I wouldn't think so.
So yeah, with the underwater treadmill. So it should not. And of course, when just talking to my office manager, how many we saw this summer, I think with people, brachial plexus lesions, with people driving around more and the dogs, all of them jumped out of a car. But starting appropriately with the water height pretty high, just to attempt to get some weight bearing. So if it's done properly, it should not be contraindicated at all. So it may just have been their comfort level, or, you know, thinking they were running in there like the dogs with Taylor Swift. So they'll start, you know, certainly a little bit slower.
Okay, I have one final question for you because we really are over time. This one's actually from me.
Okay.
So since you have your dogs look up 5 times before they get their meal, have they gotten to where they do it faster and faster and faster to get their food sooner?
Good question. So I'm a raw feeder. So I actually will not dig my hands into the raw. So I put it on a spoon and they know that they have to move slow. But I have had clients say that. So, you know, just kind of working with them that they have to do it slow and nice. You know, they are smarter than we are, but no, my guys know they get they're raw on a spoon and they have to move slowly. So very good question.
So this was just wonderful. And there were lots and lots of thank you, thank you, thank you. It's a very good webinar. Really learned a lot in the chat. So excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you, Deb. That was wonderful. And again, I'm sorry for the stress to begin with.
Oh, no. Not at all. Thank you so much, everyone. Stay warm and stay healthy.
Yep, and thank you all for coming. And we'll see some of you guys next week for the holistic medical decision-making session about joints and arthritis.
Thank you.
Stay warm.
Bye, everybody. Right,
bye-bye. Thank you.